Laser for inviting us group, us team, to present you some information about cognitive remediation in the 22Q deletion syndrome. So, as you guess, I'm replacing Professor Caroline Daly, who unfortunately can't be with us today. And we are working together in a reference center named Genopsy in Lyon, France. It's a national reference center for rare disease with genetic etiology and psychiatric symptoms, including the deletion syndrome. And we are currently developing some cognitive remediation program. That's why I will speak about this topic today. But before I get that, I have to give you some information about cognitive abilities in the deletion syndrome. As you know, cognitive abilities are heterogeneous in the deletion syndrome. Patients may have some strengths, some skills in several cognitive areas, such as long-term memory or verbal reasoning. But they have also some weaknesses in comparison with the normal range. Cognitive impairment mainly concern attention, visuospatial skills, and social cognition. This is a broad profile of cognitive abilities in the deletion syndrome, but keep in mind that there is also an high heterogeneity between patients. So, in all cases, a complete and individual cognitive assessment is required to draw the cognitive profile of a patient. So, cognitive impairment may have some important consequences. It can impair schooling or working. It can limit autonomy in daily life. It can also have some consequences on behavior or social interaction. Let me show you an example. Some patients have some impairment in visual attention area. That is to say, they are unable to pay attention to all visual information. So consequently, facing a social scene, as in this example, they can omit some important information, for example, the box with the red cross or the broken bike. And if you focus only on the little girl, the shoe, the man, you can conclude that the man is angry and is telling to the little girl to hurry up and to put her shoes on. This is a misinterpretation, and if you have a misinterpretation, you have consequently an inappropriate behavior when you meet the man or the girl. This is an example. Anyway, cognitive impairment is an important area of concern in clinical care of patients with the deletion syndrome. So, what can we do? There is different care strategies. First of all, we can adjust our own behavior toward the patient. We can use very clear instruction. We can modify our expectation to help the patient. The patients can also use physical adaptation and physical equipment to bypass some cognitive difficulties. For example, in case of severe dysgraphia, that is the inability to draw the letter, you can use a keyboard with a computer, and it can help to write. And the third care strategy is to develop the own skills of the patient. And in fact, cognitive remediation is a therapy that helps to develop the personal skills of the patients. How can we define the cognitive remediation? It's a non-pharmacological therapy improving cognitive functions and daily life adaptative skills. And there is four mainstay, four keywords. The first one is interactive process. In a cognitive remediation therapy, the patient and the coach will collaborate together with the same goal. The patient plays an active role, and the coach is not exactly a teacher, it's not a teacher, but he helps the patient to find himself the solution. Active coaching is very important. Scientific studies have demonstrated that a cognitive remediation therapy with active coaching gets better results than cognitive training without coach. That is to say, when the patient is alone in front of a computer and is doing exercise alone. So interactive process is very interesting. Is very important. Sorry. The second keyword is concrete goals. In the cognitive remediation therapy, the goals of the therapy is defined at the beginning of the therapy, and it always a concrete goals. For instance, the goal can be to get a license driving. In this example, improving attentional abilities is the way to achieve the goal, but it's not the goal of the therapy. And concrete goals are very important to improve patients' motivation. The third word is alternative strategy. Alternative strategies, and it's the most important word. In a cognitive remediation therapy, we use the strengths, the skills, the cognitive skills of the patient to develop alternative strategies and then circumvent cognitive inabilities, cognitive impairment. Let me give you an example of a physical impairment. Here, if you are tall, you can look over the gate. But if you are small, you can't. But you can use an alternative strategy. You can use a box, cut a box, and climb on the box. And after that, you can see, you can look over the gate. It's exactly the same with cognitive abilities. For example, imagine you have to learn this visual pattern and to draw from memory. If you have a poor visual memory, you can use an alternative strategy. You can use verbal memory, another skill, and you can learn, for example, this is a square, a pink square with an 8-branch star, and the star is yellow and purple, and so on. You can learn this verbal information, and after that, we can draw from memory without using visual memory. The last word is metacognition. Metacognition is very important. It's the ability to know our cognitive functions are working. What are my skills, what are my impairments, my weaknesses. And it's very important to know this information to develop alternative strategies. So the coach helps the patient to develop their own metacognitive abilities. There are a lot of cognitive remediation programs, and cognitive remediation is used for several years. And the efficacy has been proven in different clinical conditions, such as schizophrenia, attentional disorder, autism spectrum disorder, mood and anxiety disorder. You have to notate that all of these conditions can occur in the deletion syndrome. You have some, on the right of the slide, you can see some example of cognitive remediation program. I have no time to explain all of these programs in detail, but and some are focused on one cognitive areas other include several communities, areas, it depends. There is individual therapy or group therapy, but in any case, cognitive remediation programs are intensive therapy. That is to say, they are sometimes two or three sessions per week. But it's also a time-limited therapy. It lasts 3 or 4 months, sometimes 6 months, it depends, but it's time-limited. The scientific, the clinical study found significant effects of cognitive remediation programs. It can improve cognitive function, decrease psychiatric symptoms. It can improve social functioning, self-esteem, quality of life, and it can also decrease the number of psychiatric admissions. So it's very interesting. Now cognitive remediation programs are tools among various tools in rehabilitation center for psychiatric rehabilitation center. But of course, it's not miraculous. It's not a miraculous therapy. There is some important issue and challenges with this therapy. And patients with psychiatric symptoms have not to stop their drugs, of course. The antipsychotic drugs aims to allows to easing psychological distress and delusion and so on. And after that, cognitive remediation can help to improve functioning in daily life. But both are important. So, about issues and challenges of cognitive remediation programs. Some are general, some are more specific to the delusion syndrome. The first one is motivation. Motivation is very important, motivation of the patient, but also if it is a child, the parents' motivation, because they have to play an active role during the programs. And all stuff about cognitive remediation programs have to be explained before beginning the therapy. The second one, and this is the most important challenge, it's a generalization of skills, because the ultimate goal is improving functioning in daily life. So patients have to reuse their strategies that they learn during the therapy in daily life. And sometimes for patients, it's very difficult. That's why in almost all of programs, there is at-home activities. It's not exactly homeworks, but it's an activity of daily life. And each week, the coach and the patient choose a daily life activity, for example, shopping, that is difficult. And he have to reuse the strategies he learned during the session, during this activity. Some issues are specific to the delusion syndrome. The first important thing to say is that I present before global programs that was designed for schizophrenic patient of autism in autism conditions. But sometimes the cognitive and behavioral profile in the delusion syndrome is more complex and more specific. And this morning we speak about the interest of a small group with only 22Q11 deletion syndrome patients to improve social skills and social skills training. And we'll see later that some research group and clinicians developed or adapted their programs to the specific profile of the deletion syndrome. The second issue is the need of active coaching. And sometimes in case of rare disease, it's very difficult to have an active coaching because the distance between the rehabilitation center and the home of the patient is high. So it's an issue. And we'll see that web conferencing could be a good trade-off in this case. The last point is that we have some clinical studies, but they are only preliminary. So the experimental design is not very, very well in some cases. There is no group, no control group, no randomized procedures. So we have not a complete picture of the advantages and the drawbacks of cognitive remediation in the deletion syndrome. But we have preliminary, very interesting information. Concerning neurocognition, I will show only some studies. Concerning neurocognition, in this American studies, there is only cognitive training with self-administered computerized program. But nevertheless, they found preliminary positive results on cognitive performance of children. In the studies of the Mariano's team, they use a computerized program with active coaching by web conferencing, and they demonstrated there is an improvement of cognitive flexibility, reaction times, and other cognitive performance. And most interestingly, they found that the improvement of cognition is still present 6 months after the end of the therapy. It suggests that cognitive remediation is sustainable, and it's very important. In Lyon, in our team, we developed the Cognitus et moi program. And this cognitive remediation program is interesting in the case of the deletion syndrome for 3 reasons. The first one is that this tool is designed to train the attentional and visuospatial skills of children, and these cognitive areas are often impaired. The second thing is the therapy is highly adaptable. We can adapt the therapy to the child's clinical profile because there is a various set of exercise and the coach is chosen the most interesting exercise, and all stuff in this program is adapted to the child's clinical profile. So it's interesting in case of very complex social and cognitive and behavior profile. And the last thing is that we train the child to reuse their strategy in different contexts. Because in each session, there is, first of all, paper and pencil case activity, computerized activity, and at-home activity. And the child has to reuse the same strategy in the different contexts to help the generalization of their skills. Sorry. Concerning social cognition, this morning we spoke about several programs, the peer programs, the Babel and Do programs, and group therapy in the Hospital of Barcelona. We'll present you other things in the study of Shashi in the United States. They used small group therapy with homeworks and a coach procedure, and they found a good feasibility and a qualitative and quantitative improvement of cognitive functioning. The Geneva group adapted a cognitive remediation program to the specific social profile of the patient with the deletion syndrome, so it's very interesting. And they used video conferencing in small groups. They also found qualitative and quantitative improvements of social skills of the patients. In our group, we developed RCK programs that aims to improve the ability of the patient to recognize facial emotions. And the main interest of the program is the use of eye tracking procedure. You know that to recognize the emotional information in the face, some areas of the face are more important than the other. For example, the eyes are very important. So, and we know that in the deletion syndrome, some patients are unable to focus the face correctly. And when you use eye tracking, you know where the child is paying attention, where he's looking for. So you can correct the child's performance activity during the therapy with these eye tracking feedbacks. My colleagues use a case study methodology and they found an improvement of emotion identification in the patient with in children with the deletion syndrome. So to conclude, we can say that cognitive remediation is a useful therapy in case of psychiatric conditions. More specifically, in the deletion syndrome, we have only preliminary results, but they are all highly encouraging. So cognitive remediation is a useful therapy, but there is several conditions of use. The first one is we have to choose a program that is adapted to the patient's clinical profile and project. So before beginning the therapy, an exhaustive and clinical and neuropsychological assessment is needed to know what are the cognitive strengths, what are the cognitive weaknesses, because during the therapy we have to use also the strengths of the patients. And patients and also parents' motivation is very important. The second condition of use is clinical stability. If the patient is very sad, very anxious, or have many hallucinations, it's not a good idea to begin a cognitive remediation program. I think that antipsychotic drugs have not to be discontinued, but minimal dose efficacy is required because we know that some drugs cause some cognitive slowing. The third point is indeed the same as the first. In case of intellectual disability, you have to know that there is a few cognitive remediation programs designed for people with intellectual disability. So, we have to very carefully choose the program and to verify that it can be adapted to intellectual disability. For instance, the Cognitus et moi programs can be adapted in this case because it's a very flexible program. But some ones are too difficult for these patients. And the last point is active coaching. Active coaching is very important. But sometimes web conferencing could be a good alternative. So thank you for your attention.